The reason I wrote this book was because I had a sense that this big, complicated national health reform law, known alternately as the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, and a lot worse, whatever you want to call it, that people would need to have a variety of ways to try to understand it and understand what it is as a law. Normally, when a law passes, the public interest is here, wherever, whether it's here or here, but it's here. But after it passes, then it kind of goes down this way. And whether you like it or not, we're not going to have the opportunity to have attention go down this way, because the November 6, 2012 federal elections is going to be a national plebiscite on this law. I mean, just make no mistake about it. It's not going to be the Supreme Court case that's going to decide this. It's going to be all of you on November 6, 2012. And so because of that, I think as people look at this, there's the hope that people might actually want to try and take some time and try to understand it as a law itself.
You know, you open up your book with this recap of a 2008 meeting. Kind of all the people that ever tried to get their hands around health reform got together in a room, at least most of y'all, and talked about successes and failures and were looking towards the future. What did you learn there? And, you know, did it influence the success of the law?
Well, there was a strong effort from the get-go by Democrats much more than Republicans to learn lessons from prior health reform efforts that had failed and to incorporate those lessons. If you wanted to get health reform done, you had to start really quickly. You couldn't wait. The Clinton administration started in January 1993, but they started by setting up this 500-person task force. And they ended up not getting a bill to the Congress until November 1993. The commitment and the passion and the interest and the political power and influence of the Clinton administration was already diminishing by that point in time. And so that's why there was this sense of urgency from the very beginning to get going right away. The Clinton administration tried to write the entire law and make it a White House product and hand it to Congress and say, here it is, do this. And there was they were heavily criticized for that, for not letting Congress do its work. And so in this case, the Obama administration was heavily involved and deeply involved at every step of the process, every inch along the way, and gave substantial deference to Congress to do the actual writing and constructing of the provisions itself so that they would feel ownership of it. When Ronald Reagan was president, Congress and the president, overwhelming majorities in the House and the Senate, passed a law known as the Medicare Catastrophic Coverage Act, which included for the first time an outpatient prescription drug benefit for all elderly and disabled enrollees in Medicare and a lot of other benefits. And it also included some new assessments, taxes, fees, whatever you want to call it, on higher income Medicare enrollees to help pay for the cost of the bill. And the way that law was structured, because Congress wanted to be fiscally responsible, they actually imposed the higher fees before the benefits and expansions actually started to roll out. And they helped to precipitate this fierce reaction by elements of the senior citizen community, which led to 18 months later, when President George H.W. Bush signed a complete repeal of the Medicare Catastrophic Act. So one of the lessons from that was, so while you can't necessarily do all of it right at the start, you have to build into the law a lot of benefits and changes that people will see right away. And so if you go into the big health access expansion of the law in Title I of the law, you'll see in subtitles A and B immediate benefits to Americans.
I know that you mentioned in your book that Senator Kennedy made one strategic decision, which was to try to set up the process so that you could do reconciliation if you wanted to. Talk about that a little bit, and if there were any other strategic decisions that were made that kind of made this possible.
So the senator was involved as much as he could, and but was not at all involved at the extent that he had been in prior health reform or in prior legislative efforts. But nonetheless, he picked a small number of issues that he felt were critically important to the fate of the success or failure of health reform. And he did everything he possibly could from his bed, from his home, from the times when he's able to come to the Capitol to try to lock those in. So one of them dealt with this obscure and vitally important legislative process known as budget reconciliation. Most people who follow the Senate know something called the rule of 60. If the opponents want to stop you, it doesn't matter whether they're Republicans or Democrats, if they can prevent you from getting to 60 votes, they can stop you from doing just about anything, except if you do something through a budget reconciliation vehicle, in which case it can pass with limited debate, no ability to filibuster, and it only requires 51 votes to pass. And so Senator Kennedy was absolutely determined to make sure that in setting up this process in February and March of 2009, so the first months of the Obama administration, when we were still in this era of good feeling around health reform, Senator Kennedy knew that that wouldn't last and that it was vitally important to maintain an avenue, if necessary, to use budget reconciliation. The Republicans were concerned that Democrats would create a whole health reform law and ram it through using only the budget reconciliation process. And Democrats did not want to do that, on the other hand, did not want to unilaterally surrender that opportunity if they were dealing with Republican intransigence. So there was a strategic decision made by the leadership of the Senate and the House to leave open the possibility of budget reconciliation, but to use that only as a last resort. And so when Democrats got their 60th vote, when Senator Specter from Pennsylvania switched parties unexpectedly in the early spring of 2009, and when the Minnesota Senate recount was done and Al Franken took his seat, Democrats had 60 votes and didn't need to use reconciliation. And so the major bills, the House and the Senate bills, were done without reconciliation. But then, many of you may remember, on January 19, 2010, there was a special election in a state called Massachusetts for the late Senator Kennedy's seat, and it was surprisingly won by the Republican candidate, and Democrats no longer had 60 votes, they had 59 votes, and there were no Republicans willing to support, and so reconciliation was used at the final stage in late March 2010 as a way to make some changes in the law, not doing the whole law, but making some critically important changes that allowed the majorities to be accumulated to get passage.
Tell us, you know, this big law, the 2,000 pages we keep talking about, what does it do?
I like to look at a federal law and think of it like, you know, a book has chapters, a play has acts and scenes, a baseball game has innings, and a federal law, a federal statute, has titles. So it's made up of titles. And so this law has 10 titles. And this is a landmark law. This is a law, if you want, in terms of United States social welfare policy, that you have to compare with the Social Security Act of 1935 and the Medicare and Medicaid Act of 1965. And it really doesn't have a peer beyond those two laws. So it's something that doesn't happen every Congress, every decade, every generation. It seems to be something that happens like almost every second or third generation. I like to talk about, it's not just a landmark law, but it is a landmark full of smaller landmarks. And so if you just sort of let me do it in 45 seconds, a run through the 10 titles. Title I revolutionizes private health insurance in the United States, completely changes it and puts it on a different platform. Title II takes Medicaid, which most Americans think is the program that provides health insurance to poor people. And in truth, it has always been the program that provides health insurance to some poor people. And beginning in 2014, if implemented as structured, it will in fact be a health insurance program for all poor people in the United States. Title III is the most ambitious set of provisions ever passed by the Congress to improve the quality, efficiency, and effectiveness of medical care delivered in the United States, and does some important changes to the Medicare program. Title IV, I'm sure one of your favorites, is probably the most ambitious federal statute ever passed to promote prevention and wellness, to create a federal structure that cares about trying to help people keep healthy so that they don't get sick. Title V is an extensive set of provisions to promote a better, more robust healthcare workforce that will be prepared to treat about 32 million newly insured Americans who will start coming on the insurance rolls in 2014. Title VI is a grab bag, but I'll just mention one or two of the grab. One of them is fraud and abuse. And I'll mention one other thing in Title VI that was worked on for over 10 years in a bipartisan way, is referred to as the Elder Justice Act. A Title VII, for the first time, directs the Food and Drug Administration to allow the manufacture and marketing of what are known as biosimilars. They're generic-like equivalents for biopharmaceutical drugs, which is the growth and the future of the drug industry in the United States. A Title VIII is potentially, if it gets off the ground, a new voluntary national disability program known as CLASS, Community Living Assistance Services and Supports, that if it is implemented, and it has a very rocky road to implementation, but if it is implemented, will be a revolution in how we treat people with disabilities in the United States. And Title IX is a lot of money to pay for it. And Title X is the so-called Manager's Amendment, and you're going to have to read the book if you want to find out what's in Title IX. It takes too long to explain. It would take the whole night. So that's what it is. If we had pushed for single-payer Medicare for all, we would have put together a great bill that would be look really nice on a shelf, but never would have happened. Here's the point, okay? We had a lot of people in the course of this debate. I heard them, there were a bunch of Republicans too. So Senator Coburn from Oklahoma, right? He had his own health reform bill that he would hold up. He'd say, here it is. I got it. Covers everybody. Less cost. Tastes great. Less filling. Why don't you just do it, right? And Senator Gregg had his own plan. And Senator, and there were all these plans, okay? So the challenge was not, could anybody dream up their perfect version of what health reform should be? The challenge was, in the Congress in 2009 and 2010, could we craft a piece of legislation that could achieve majority support in the House and 60 votes in the Senate? So the issue of the so-called individual mandate. Okay. And by the way, it's really not an individual mandate. What it is it is a penalty, a financial penalty, if you can afford to buy health insurance and don't do so. If you pay the penalty, that's your choice. You don't have to buy health insurance. Switzerland has an individual mandate. If you refuse to buy health insurance, the government buys it for you and sends you a bill and makes sure you pay. Okay? That's a mandate, okay? This is different. In June of 2009, Chuck Grassley, again, Senator Grassley, who I have a lot of respect for, he's got a lot of integrity, he's a really interesting guy. But he said on Fox News, he said, well, you know, listen, we've all just got to be grown-ups about this and understand there's no way we can make this work unless we've got a mandate in there in the system in some way, okay? And then in September 2009, 3 months later, again on Fox, he said the reason he opposes this legislation is because of the individual mandate, okay? So what happened? The one incident that I would just put forward is in late July 2009, Senator Jim DeMint from South Carolina was on a conference call with a host of conservative activists all around the country. And the issue of health care came up. And he said, and it was quoted, and he didn't deny it, that he said it. He said, listen, if we can defeat Obama on health care, it will ruin his agenda, and destroy his presidency. And that's what we want to do. Okay? So there were people in this, there were lots of Republicans who were just very policy-wise wanting to get something done and wanting to find that middle ground. And that's how we operated in functions, trying to find that space, whether it was early or late, different strategies for how to do it, all in the Senate. In the Senate, there was a real attempt to try to do it. And at a certain point, the members, the Republicans, just got freaked out, I believe, by what was happening on the ground politically, and starting to realize one by one that if they held for this, they were going to face real damage in their own backyard. There was a divide at the start between the policy serious Republicans and the politically oriented Republicans. But as the process moved forward, that divide diminished and diminished and diminished until the last one to give up the ghost was Olympia Snowe from Maine. She gave up in early December, and then there was just nothing, and it was done totally by Democrats in March, finally. And what could have been done differently? I just honestly believe that what would be maximally acceptable to Republicans in the environment in which we were operating, and what would be minimally acceptable for Democrats, given the exuberance of the Obama victory and the expectations that were created, was just a bridge too far. I mean, there were people of goodwill on both sides who tried to do it, and at the end of the day, I just think it wasn't there to be done. And because there were sufficient votes and a path for Democrats to do it, they figured out a way to do it. Will we get to a better system than what the Affordable Care Act envisions? I don't know. I don't even know if we're going to get to the vision of what the Affordable Care Act envisions. I mean, talk to me on November 7th, 2012, and I'll give you a more solid answer. I think if there's one place that I'm watching that is kind of like my star of hope right now, I'm watching the state of Vermont, which is actually trying to pursue its own version of single payer between now and 2017, and to do it. But here's the important thing that I don't think people understand about Vermont, is that the Vermonters are more able to consider doing what they're trying to do, not in spite of the Affordable Care Act, but because of the Affordable Care Act. If they can use the waiver authority in Title I to redirect all those subsidies into their system, then their challenge in terms of creating that kind of a system is infinitely easier financially and politically than it would otherwise be.